not on March 22nd deadline. So we are in March 11th. And I recommend everyone to register. I know some folks went through a lot of miserable times because of all this pandemic stuff, and I know that it's not easy, but I know based on the questions that come before me, you guys are doing a great job. So just keep on pushing at it. Just keep in mind, March 22nd, register, and if you, for some reason, whatever it is, are not able to come for whatever reasons, let's say pandemic gotten to you, like God forbid, or let's say you have extraordinary circumstances. Number one, so you are welcome to jump into my summer class. So it will be starting sometime either late June or July. I still haven't made up my mind about it. And number two, you can always cancel and get your money back. So that $390, it will take them some time to return it. But as long as you notify them 2 days in advance, hopefully before that, but two days in advance, I think that's the rule. They're not gonna keep your money. They're gonna give you a refund. So just a note on this stuff as well. Okay, well, see, coronavirus is coronavirus, so it's not good. I have no comment on that other than this is a miserable thing that goes around. Another interesting statistic I want to point out, it's not related to the exam, it's related to the customs in general. I think you guys gonna find it interesting. This new report about employee arrests came out. So in other words, if you want to know how many people work for customs, you have this data, and this data says that you have 2018 you have 60,000 people, right? 60,014. In 2019 you had 61,500 people working for CBP. Keep in mind that CBP does not include like other DHS stuff, like ICE, for example. I'm not even sure if it includes the Border Patrol, because Border Patrol, you know, those guys that are on the front lines, running around the south border and catching all those illegal aliens. Most of them are not CBP, they're Border Patrol. I'm not sure if they count towards that. But it's mostly the ladies and gentlemen which wear those blue uniforms, CBP uniforms. So 2020, the coronavirus year, 63,500. So there is an increase. And the question is, how many of those people get arrested? You know, arrest is not a conviction. And arrest means that there is something that went on, right? So we have a statistic here. Let me see if I can get it up. Yeah, we have a statistic here. So according to the released report, we have in 2021, so out of the 60,000 people, we only had 81 arrests altogether. This is, we're still in 2021, so probably there will be more. But basically, we see the trend, right? 2018 was the highest, right? 288. And then 2019 kept on going down. And in 2020, it also reached its low, according to the statistics. Meaning probably that the pandemic times had this effect where people decided to come down and worry about greater, I guess, reflect back and think about greater things in life than getting arrested. It also may mean that before you could go to the bar, right? Not, and drinking and driving, although it's something very bad, it does happen. And now you couldn't do that anymore because a lot of bars were closed up. So, with that in mind, I thought that was an interesting statistic to share with you. They just came out with it, so I thought that this would be kind of curious. All right, so next on the list, we have curious individual who pointed out something extremely good that I didn't think of before. And now I thought of it, so I really appreciate for bringing this up. So, okay, this is I'm dropping down the link so you guys can download all the stuff. It's really the same stuff that is from the last chapter. Few streams back, remember someone asked me when we were talking about forums, they said, hey, listen, what's going on with the forums? Give us a spreadsheet and things like that. And I said, no, I don't do this type of stuff. I usually put it in a chapter so I can put it down in a context. But you can use that chapter to make sure that this is almost like an outline or almost like the spreadsheet, right? So, but then I failed to explain how those forms were organized because if you don't know the organization, you cannot be a good librarian, right? So again, that's something that I didn't do, and I don't think I ever done it before because I have it in my head, and for some reason, it's part of intellectual bias. I kind of assume that you guys are also thinking that because I have the information, and but I failed to share it with you. So let me do this right now. So going to this commonly tested forums, the way it is organized in alpha numerical order. As you can see, the chapter itself is about 25 pages long, and it starts with alpha letter. So we have pretty much three agencies which CBP examiners have tested on. One is Customs CBP, of course, or sometimes CF. Another one is EPA. And another one is US Fish and Wildlife. Those are the primary ones that I have seen so far as forms are concerned. So obviously C is in the beginning of the alphabet, so I start with CBP forms first. So that's the alpha part. The numeric part goes, of course, in the increasing order. So I start with the one that takes place at the bottom hierarchy. It doesn't mean anything as far as the CFR is concerned. As you can see, the CBP Form 19, which was tested previously on the CBP on the exam, it comes from part 174, which is not really the first one. It's actually towards the end. So, but for now, CBP Form 19 is the form which deals with the protest, right? So whenever you try to navigate, you see, as you can see, you have increasing order of forms. So then comes 214. So the next in the increasing is 255. The next one is, well, there is 301, 434, and so on and so on. So if you happen to open it in the middle of the chapter, right, and you know the choice of forms, and the way you would know this is or the way you would get to this is, as you can see from the question itself, customs examiners present you with the choice of forms, right? So Whatever you have here, you have choice of forms, and you know those are the CBP forms. So C, and you start from the one here, you go to the next one, and you go to the next one, and you can like fit in the stuff through the fact pattern. This is so without knowing this, this is not in random, but if it's something which is once you know that it is an alphanumeric order, you save yourself some time by going through this and becoming actually a librarian instead of looking you over for that form, right? So hopefully this is something that I did fail to mention. And if you go to the this is CBP stuff, right? So if you fast forward to the other agencies, right? You have you have EPA, right? They ask questions about EPA form before, which is Environmental Protection Agency. Here it is, right? And then you have U.S. Fish and Wildlife form, which also been asked on the exam, and you have it here. Fortunately, with Fish and Wildlife, it's not that difficult, because this is the only form on the list. But this is the methodology you should keep in mind nevertheless. So hopefully that clears up the navigation process and how you should go about it with respect to the forms. So that's the last chapter of the volume 2 of the textbook. I think it is chapter 31. No. 32. All right. So now, that's with respect to chapter 32. The next on the list also brought up, and I kind of messed up on communicating the message and was afraid to make people confused. So I decided to kind of pull this one out and just talk through this. All right. So my last update on this textbook was around 2017, and the way I make up for it, for the updated stuff, is through communication such as this one, through running a class, through running a stream, through doing a handout. By the way, the latest update for the one, so the one I sent you, which is in the book, don't use it. The one I sent you after that, don't use it. But this one, I'm sending it right now. I just sent the link right now for Toxic Substance Control Act. Use that one. Because I kind of get carried away and I send you the same PDF file as I used in the book, where I kind of gave heads up to what's heading, and what was heading at the time was the elimination of the toxic blanket certificate form. One of the things that happens on a customs broker license exam, as you probably have noticed, customs examiners, they love to ask on the little minuscule details, like laundry list of items, and which are very particular, and which really have not much to do with the general knowledge, but really ask you to be a librarian and to locate this stuff. So one of these popular line items on a customs broker license exam back in the day, we're talking about before that 2016 customs, the Federal Register notice, was the blanket certification. So let me locate this stuff. Okay, right there. The final, so back right around the time, or like right before the time this particular book went to print, they eliminated the blanket certification process, which was pretty much the idea behind it is to say, okay, so here is a paper. Here is the list of requirements submitted to the port. The port will maintain it, and so that way you don't have to do too much paperwork on per entry basis. So, but customs since then, they moved out from this paper-driven process. They moved out from this port-driven process to the Center of Excellence and Expertise process, right, where they have a assignment to the center, and you are not port subject matter expert, but you be kind of like the item subject matter experts. So in this way, you have customs reviewing this, and they took it out. So that was when? That was 2016, right before the 2017, right? The December 27th, 2000. 17. So since then I've done so when they came out, remember, and this applies to you guys in this situation because you guys are dealing with NAFTA, right? Because NAFTA is no longer around, but you still have NAFTA on the books which you will be tested on. So the same situation I was faced back a few years ago when this thing came out because the examinees, they were being tested on this stuff, but it was no longer the good law. And it also serves actually as a good example for those of you who are started. I haven't assigned it yet. It's going to the assign this assignment will be next week. Focus of this week, remember, focus of this week is evaluation, right? Very difficult stuff. So get some background on evaluation. The FTAs, the free trade agreements, they will come next week. But some of you I know, because some of you brought these questions to me. You already started working on the FTAs, free trade agreements, and in this is a good example of let's say North American free trade agreement, which came out of its legal existence in end of June. Either end of June or beginning of July last year, I think July 1st. So when it went out, you still be tested on it, but will you be tested so much on it? Well, I looked through the customs exams after this Federal Register notice came out eliminating toxic swabs, the blanket certification process, and there was not much. So I was very much pleased to really reduce the chapter, eliminate most of the stuff, and reduce the chapter, take out the blanket certification process out. It's just another ministerial kind of like a line item breakdown thing to worry about. It doesn't make you knowing this stuff doesn't make you smarter in any way, trust me. So the updated outline, I the latest one, the one is there. I just sent, and it deals with well, first of all, we have to kind of establish where the toxic substances control stuff items are found, and they're found in Part 12. They are 12.1 as far as, of course, customs is concerned, right? Because we also have we have this stuff, right? The chemical substance inventory, the EPA. So EPA is the agency which is responsible for administration of all this stuff. The chemicals in general, they are huge as far as importation is concerned. I think I already mentioned example where you bring stuff in, right? Like you have a pen, and pen has ink. Ink is a chemical, so you have to make a declaration. Is it using the chemicals which are not subject to the Toxic Substances Control Act, or they are subject to Toxic Substances Control Act? If they are not, how do you check? So the question is, so you are the licensed customs broker, so you are the agent, so you rely on importer of record. But let's say you work for the compliance department, right, of the importer, right, of the corporate importer, let's say Office Depot, right, and or they've been bought by Staples, I think. So it doesn't matter, wherever, right? So importer of record, the idea is for bringing someone who is an employee who works in a compliance department is to reduce liability. So if you're not reducing liability, you're not doing a good job. That means that you have to show that you do somehow the diligence, and because you are the importer of record or you work for the importer of record, you are doing that by checking the inventory. So in this case, someone will come to you and say, let's say the Japanese manufacturer that makes pilot pens, right? I think they're made in Japan. So you have that the Japanese exporter says, "Oh, here's the paper," and you say, "Okay, so what type of chemicals have you been using?" And then they're like, "Why are you asking me those questions?" And here's a piece of paper. I'm like, "All right. I just want to make sure what you are not just signing away the stuff you don't know about. If you sign, you say it's not subject to Toxic Substance Control Act, then obviously the stuff behind you're aware of, or someone who you asked, who told you to sign it, is aware of. Otherwise, you're just you're just doing that naked, what they call it, a naked certification. So if you say it to someone who would usually be in the position of a manager, most likely they say, well, this is in the regular course of business, stuff like that. But if you don't say it too nicely, they may get offended. Who do you think you are? Blah blah blah. But in any case, you document this. If most of the time they'll work with you because obviously you're doing the diligent thing, and they'll get together with their department for the production. Usually it will be the chemist, and they'll get you the stuff. You put the stuff in the database, you check it out, and you're good to go. Whew. So that's EPA stuff, but that's the stuff for the most of the stuff is for the real world. For the our customs broker license exam, this EPA stuff, this registry stuff, and inventory checking, you are not going to need to do that. You have enough things to worry about. So I'm just gonna drop down the link for the fun of it. But of course I'm gonna go back to the outline and we'll focus on the stuff that really matters.